तो इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी कवर्ड वेरियस हार्मोनल डिस्टरबेंसेस ऑफ एड्रीनल कॉर्टेक्स. इन दिस वी विल डिस्कस वेरियस ट्यूमर्स ऑफ एड्रीनल कॉर्टेक्स एज वेल एज मेडुला. स्टार्टिंग विद द क्लासिफिकेशन, एज वी नो दैट एड्रीनल कॉर्टेक्स एंड मेडुला दे आर डेवलपमेंटली स्ट्रक्चरली एंड फंक्शनली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम ईच अदर. Similarly, the tumors that arise in these two different regions of adrenal, they are also different. So, in adrenal cortex, we have a benign tumor called as cortical adenoma and a malignant one called as cortical carcinoma or adrenocortical carcinoma. Then, tumors of adrenal medulla. In this, we have pheochromocytoma, which is a benign tumor. Then, we have neuroblastoma, myelolipoma, and ganglioneuroma. So amongst these, we will be discussing cortical adenoma, cortical carcinoma, pheochromocytoma and neuroblastoma. We will not be going into much details about myelolipoma and ganglioneuroma. Before we start with the first entity, which is cortical adenoma, I just want to highlight that secondaries, they are much more common in adrenal as compared to primary tumors. Starting with the adrenocortical tumors, first is cortical adenoma. So as it is an adenoma, so it is a benign tumor of adrenal cortex. It is the most common tumor of the cortex and it is indistinguishable from hyperplastic nodules of adrenal cortex, both grossly as well as microscopically. So the cutoff limit that is arbitrarily taken to differentiate hyperplastic nodules from adrenal cortical adenoma is 2 cm. If the size of the mass is less than 2 cm, then it is called hyperplastic nodule, and if it is more than 2 cm, then it is labeled adrenal cortical adenoma. Now these cortical adenomas, they are usually non-functional and hence they are asymptomatic. Unlike when we had discussed in the last lecture about pituitary adenomas, where most of them are functional. Now these cortical adenomas, they can be either isolated or as a part of MEN1 syndrome. Morphologically, grossly these tumors, they are well circumscribed just like any benign tumor. They are usually solitary and small, 2 to 5 cm in size. This is roughly a guideline, but we can see that the minimum size has to be 2 cm for it to qualify as an adrenal cortical adenoma. If it is less than 2 cm, then we will label it as hyperplastic nodule. And there is no upper limit. Cut section, these tumors, they are bright yellow because of the presence of high content of lipid in these cells. In the gross picture on the right, we can see a yellow colored, well circumscribed, almost lobulated tumor which is located in the adrenal cortex, and outside this yellow box we can also see this line like structure which is yellow in color. This is the remnant normal cortex, and this brownish appearance towards the center, it is the remaining normal adrenal medulla. Next is microscopic appearance. The tumor cells, they are arranged in trabeculae and sheets. They resemble the cells of zona fasciculata, which is the middle layer of normal adrenal cortex, and some atypia can be seen in these cells despite it being a benign tumor. So this atypia is a characteristic of endocrine malignancies and it can be seen in any benign endocrine tumor, and this is called as endocrine atypia. And this atypia does not necessarily qualify the tumor for malignancy. Now, functional adenomas, they have atrophy of adjacent cortex because they themselves are also secreting excess of hormones, and because of that, there is downregulation of normal surrounding cortex. Non-functional adenomas, they will have a normal cortex. Next is adrenocortical carcinoma. These are rare tumors and they can occur in any age group. These are more likely to be functional as compared to adrenocortical adenomas, which are usually non-functional. And these are often associated with virilism because of their expression of sex steroids. Grossly, these tumors, they are large, invasive lesions which efface the native adrenal gland. That is, they infiltrate and derange or destroy the shape, normal shape of the adrenal. On cut section, they have variegated appearance and they are poorly demarcated lesions with areas of necrosis, hemorrhage, and cystic change. Advanced tumors, they have a strong tendency to invade the adrenal vein, vena cava, and lymphatics. This feature of these tumors is very important, as this is shared with renal cell carcinoma, as we had discussed earlier. They also have tendency to invade the this renal vein and vena cava, and ultimately they can reach the right side of heart. So similarly, this feature is shared with adrenocortical carcinoma, which again have very strong tendency to invade the adrenal vein and vena cava. Metastasis is both via hematogenous and lymphatic route. This is the gross appearance of an adrenal carcinoma. Inside this yellow circle, we can see there is a large tan brown to dark brown tumor. The tumor, it has a friable appearance, and this is because of the large areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. For comparison, we have this normal surrounding kidney, which is highlighted inside this blue colored box. So we can see that the tumor is almost as large as the normal kidney, which also is being compressed by the adrenal tumor. Microscopically, these tumors, they can vary from well differentiated to highly anaplastic tumors. These tumors, they comprise of sheets and nest of large polygonal to round cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. There is presence of round to bizarre to multinucleated nuclei, and the chromatin, it is coarse, and there is usually prominence of large distinct nucleoli. So in this photo micrograph, we can see that there are these nests of cells which are large in size. They have abundant pink cytoplasm, and the nuclei in some of these cells, they are binucleate and multinucleated cell can also be seen towards the right part of this photomicrograph, and we can also appreciate distinct nucleoli in many of the cells. So with this, we have covered the adrenocortical tumors, which are adrenal cortical adenoma and carcinoma. Now we'll start with medullary tumors. In these, we will discuss mainly pheochromocytoma and neuroblastoma. Pheochromocytoma is an important tumor, and at times you may get a short note on this. This tumor, it arises from chromaffin cells of adrenal medulla. As you would recall, that chromaffin cells, they are called so because of their strong affinity for chrome salts, particularly potassium dichromate, where the catecholamines that are stored in these cells, they undergo oxidation, and because of that, the color of tumor, it changes from yellow tan to dark brown. Similarly, the same reaction can also happen in presence of light. Now, these tumors, they are rare, but they are important causes of surgically correctable hypertension. So this again is a very important point, that if we identify the cause to be the cause of hypertension to be a pheochromocytoma, so the patient undergoes a surgery and is cured of hypertension. Now these tumors, what is also another special point of about these is that these are associated with a rule of 10. So what is this rule of 10? This rule of 10, it is used to remember or highlight the various aberrations that we see in this tumor, that is the features which you will normally not expect in a pheochromocytoma, or to remember special attributes to pheochromocytoma. So we will talk about these one by one. First is 10% of pheochromocytomas, they are extra-adrenal. As we said that these tumors are adrenal tumors, so at least 10% of them can be located extra-adrenally, and they are called paragangliomas there, and they can arise in carotid body and in organ of Zucker candle. So these paragangliomas and pheochromocytomas, they behave biologically also similarly, and they have the same morphology. Only thing is If they are located in the adrenal, then they are called pheochromocytoma. And if they are located in extra-adrenal sites, then they are called paragangliomas. Then 10% of pheochromocytomas, they are bilateral. And this can be as much as 50% if only familial cases are assessed. So this also needs to be borne in mind that these tumors, they can be at times bilateral. Then 10% of pheochromocytomas, they are biologically malignant. As we said right in the beginning that these tumors are benign, but at times these tumors, they may have a malignant behavior. And this malignant behavior is more common in extra-adrenal tumors, which are called paragangliomas, and in tumors with germline mutations. Then 10% of pheochromocytomas, they are not associated with hypertension. This also we initially talked about that they are the most important cause of surgically correctable hypertension, but at times they may not present with hypertension. And finally, 10% of these pheochromocytomas, they are familial, and now this figure is believed to be as many as 25% of the cases. So these are various rules of 10. One is that they can be 10% can be extra-adrenal, 10% are bilateral, 10% are biologically malignant, 10% will not be associated with hypertension, and 10% or approximately 25% they will be familial. Now, what is the genetics of these tumors? These patients, they harbor germline mutations of VHL, neurofibromatosis 1, RET gene, succinate dehydrogenase gene, and all these genes, they stabilize this particular oncogene, which is hypoxia inducible factor 1 alpha. And this leads to tumorigenesis in these patients. Coming on to clinical features of pheochromocytoma, 90% of these patients, they will present with hypertension. As we discussed in rule of 10, that 10% of these patients may not have hypertension. Now, what is so peculiar about this hypertension in these patients is that it is paroxysmal in nature. That is, these patients will not be continuously hypertensive. They will only have episodes of hypertension. And when they have these episodes of hypertension, there will be sudden rise in blood pressure. There will be palpitations, sweating, headache, tremors, and feeling of apprehension. They can also be associated with pain in abdomen, chest, nausea, and vomiting. And these paroxysms, they can be precipitated by emotional stress, exercise, changes in posture, or at times simply by a palpation of tumor. Now, why these paroxysms of hypertension occur in these patients? These are because of sudden release of large amounts of catecholamines, which are stored in chromaffin cells of these tumors. Now, these can precipitate congestive cardiac failure, pulmonary edema, myocardial infarction, ventricular fibrillation, and cerebrovascular accidents. This is also in part due to because there is sudden release of catecholamines. So there is sudden elevation in blood pressure. So this does not give the body time to adjust to these high level of blood pressure, and that can lead to all these catastrophic outcomes in these patients. So it is important to remember that these patients, they present with hypertension in almost 90% of the cases. And this hypertension also is of paroxysmal in nature. Then benign versus malignant tumors, as we discussed in rule of 10, 90% of the tumors, they will be benign, and 10% can behave in a malignant fashion. This cannot be differentiated histologically. The only criteria for a malignant pheochromocytoma is when it metastasizes to other organs. Coming on to morphology of these tumors, grossly, these are small circumscribed tumors to quite large hemorrhagic tumors. The surrounding adrenal gland, it will be compressed. If we look at the tumor in a freshly cut specimen, the tumor will have a yellow tan appearance, but with large areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. Now, upon oxidation, these tumors undergo chromaffin reaction, giving it a dark brown color. this chromaffin reaction, we have discussed earlier also that this can happen either because of exposure to light or by immersing the tumor in potassium dichromate. So the catecholamines that are stored in these tumors, they become oxidized and they give rise to this dark brown color. So that is why the name pheochromocytoma. Pheo means dusky, chroma is color, and cytoma will be tumor. So that is why the name, because of this dark brown color of the tumor, it is called pheochromocytoma. On the right, we have gross picture of a pheochromocytoma. We can see above this yellow colored line, we have a large, well circumscribed tumor, which has this tan brown appearance with dark brown areas of hemorrhage. Also, we can see this tumor that it is surrounded by a rim of this yellow colored thing, which is the normal compressed adrenal cortex. And below the line, we can see the remnant adrenal gland, where we can appreciate both adrenal cortex as well as medulla. Medulla is this brown colored thing towards the center, and cortex, it has this yellowish appearance. Next is microscopy. Microscopically, these tumors, they are composed of two types of cells. One are chromaffin cells and the other type are cystentacular cells. So chromaffin cells and cystentacular cells, they are located in different regions of the tumor, and also they have different immunohistochemical profiles. So starting with chromaffin cells, which are also called chief cells, these are polygonal to spindle shaped cells, and they form the bulk of the nest of the tumor. And these nests of tumor cells, these are surrounded by cystentacular cells, which are located at the periphery. Now these tumor cells, they are arranged in small nests or alveoli, which are called as Zellballen appearance. Zellballen means balls of cells in German. So the characteristic appearance of pheochromocytoma is Zellballen appearance. And these balls of cells, they are surrounded by a rich vascular network. And these cells, if we talk about them, they are abundant. They have this pink abundant cytoplasm. And chromatin, it is stippled, or which is also called as salt and pepper chromatin. That is the chromatin, it will be coarsely granular in nature. So this is also a very peculiar feature, that they will have a granular kind of of chromatin, which is called as stippled chromatin or salt and pepper chromatin. And at times, just like any other neuroendocrine organ, they can have bizarre nuclei. As we can see in this photomicrograph towards the right, we have a bizarre cell in the center. So that again does not qualify a tumor as a malignant tumor. The criteria for malignancy, as we had discussed earlier, for a pheochromocytoma is when the tumor metastasizes. Otherwise, we do not count these bizarre cells, or this does not indicate that the tumor is malignant. So in this photomicrograph on the right, we can see these various cells, which are arranged in a vague nesting pattern, which is called as Zellballen pattern. The cells, we can see that they have abundant pinkish cytoplasm, and these cells, they are surrounded by these capillaries, some of which are highlighted by the presence of RBCs in their lumina, which are seen in red color. Then IHC, chief cells and cystentacular cells, we had discussed earlier also that they have different locations, and they are different immunohistochemically also. Chief cells, they are located towards the center of these nests, and they form the major bulk of the nest. And cystentacular cells, they form just the rim of these nests. Now chief cells, they are positive for chromogranin and synaptophysin, whereas cystentacular cells, they are present, they are positive for S100. On electron microscopy, we can see membrane bound electron dense granules in these cells. Next is neuroblastoma. This has already been covered in pediatric tumors, so this is more of a revision. So it is a common malignant tumor of neural crest. It occurs more commonly in children below the age of 5 years. साइट ऑफ अकरेंस इज एड्रीनल मेडुला एंड पैरावर्टेब्रल ऑटोनॉमिक गैंग्लिया. अबाउट 1 to 2% ऑफ दीज केसेस दे आर फेमिलियर एंड इन दोज केसेस जर्म लाइन म्यूटेशन ऑफ एनाप्लास्टिक लिम्फोमा काइनेज जीन इज ऑब्जर्व. क्लिनिकली द ट्यूमर कैन प्रेजेंट विद ईदर लोकल सिम्टम्स इन द फॉर्म ऑफ एब्डोमिनल डिस्टेंशन और एज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल सिम्टम्स लाइक फीवर, वेट लॉस एंड मिलेज. इट स्प्रेड्स वाय हिमाटोजीनस एज वेल एज लिम्फेटिक रूट टू लिवर, लिम्फ नोड्स एंड लंग्स. हाइपरटेंशन एंड कार्सिनोइड लाइक सिंड्रोम एट टाइम्स कैन बी ऑब्जर्व्ड एंड मेटाबोलाइट्स ऑफ कैटेकोलामीन्स नेमली वेनिलाइल मेंडेलिक एसिड एंड होमोवेनिलिक एसिड दे कैन बी डिटेक्टेड इन यूरिन एंड दे कैन बी हेल्पफुल इन डायग्नोसिस ऑफ दीज पेशेंट्स. Then morphology, grossly this tumor infiltrates into the adrenal and surrounding tissues. It is a large soft lobulated tumor with grey white appearance and areas of necrosis and hemorrhage they are frequently observed. Then microscopic appearance, these form an important differential diagnosis of small round cell tumor like other small round cell tumors, for example retinoblastoma, Ewing sarcoma, acute lymphoblastic lymphoma and rhabdomyosarcoma amongst others. So as this is a small round cell tumor, so the tumor cells, they are small round and they are slightly larger than lymphocytes. Now these tumors, they have scanty to poorly defined cytoplasm and they have hyperchromatic nuclei. In the background, we can see fibrillary stroma. The tumor cells, they are arranged in sheets, nests, and with formation of pseudo rosettes, which are called as Homer-Wright rosettes. What are these pseudo rosettes? Pseudo rosettes are when a rosette is when the cell, they are arranged in the form of petals of rose. So they are arranged concentrically, and if they have this neuropil or neurofilaments in the center, then they are said to be pseudo rosettes. But if they have a true lumen, then they are called to be true rosettes. So true rosettes we see in the case of retinoblastoma as flexner interstinal rosettes, whereas these pseudo rosettes, which are called as Homer-Wright rosettes, we see in the case of this neuroblastoma where we have these neurofilaments in the center. Then again, these Homer-Wright rosettes, they have no true lumen, hence pseudo, and these tumor cells, they are arranged radially around a fibrillar core. On immunohistochemistry, again, it is synaptophysin positive, neuron specific enolase positive, and it is also positive for neurofilament and chromogranin. Again, this is a photomicrograph of neuroblastoma. We can see that the tumor, it has a stroma and it has cells. Stroma, it has this fine thread-like appearance. So fibrillary stroma is there. Abundant fibrillary stroma we can observe in this tumor, which is this pinkish thread-like structures in the background. And then we have cells. These cells, they almost resemble lymphocytes, and that is why they are a differential of small round cell tumors. So this is a small round cell tumor. Then we can see that these cells, they are arranged in cords at many places. And in this circle that I have highlighted with this yellow color, we can see that the cells, they are arranged radially around the central fibrillary core. So this is a pseudo rosette or a Homer-Wright rosette. Again, why a pseudo rosette? Because it does not have a true lumen. This picture I have taken from your textbook of Harsh Mohan. This is mainly to highlight the difference between the true rosettes and pseudo rosettes. In pseudo rosettes, as we have highlighted in this yellow colored circle, we can see that these pseudo rosettes, they have these cells, they are arranged radially around a center of these fibrillary core, whereas the true rosette, they have actually a true lumen and they do not have anything in their center. So true rosettes will be these flexner interstinal rosettes, whereas an example of a pseudo rosette will be a Homer-Wright rosette. So let's quickly recapitulate all that we discussed. We have these two regions of adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla. So the tumors of adrenal cortex and medulla, they are different. And in adrenal cortex, we have benign tumor called as adenoma and malignant tumor called as cortical carcinoma. This cortical adenoma, it is a benign tumor and usually it is a non-functional tumor. If it is less than 2 cm, then any mass lesion with a similar appearance is called as hyperplastic nodule. But if the tumor has to meet criteria of a cortical adenoma, then it has to be at least 2 cm in size. Then cortical carcinomas, these are rare tumors. These are malignant tumors and they have a strong tendency to invade adrenal vein and vena cava. Similarly, they have this abundant pinkish cytoplasm and they can be highly anaplastic. Also, they are associated with many features of they are more likely to be functional as compared to cortical adenomas, so they can present at times with virilism. Then tumors of adrenal medulla, amongst these we discussed pheochromocytoma and neuroblastoma. Pheochromocytoma, again a benign tumor but important tumor, and is associated with paroxysmal episodes of hypertension. And then we discussed various rules of 10 that are associated with these tumors, like 10% of these tumors they will not be associated with hypertension, 10% will be bilateral, then 10% will be extra-adrenal, 10% will have malignant potential, and almost 25% of these tumors they can be familial. And now these pheochromocytomas on microscopy, they have this Zellbollen appearance, where we discussed these two types of cells that are there in pheochromocytoma. One are chromaffin cells or chief cells, which form the bulk of these tumor, and then we have sustentacular cells, which are located in the periphery of these tumor nests. And in between these tumor cells, we have these fine proliferating capillaries. We have neuroblastoma. Neuroblastoma, again, it is a important pediatric tumor, and this is a differential of small round cell tumor in children. This tumor, it has these small round cells and it has fibrillary stroma, and this tumor, it has these pseudo rosettes, which are called as Homerite rosettes. And diagnostically, these tumors, these can be identified by presence of metabolites of catecholamines in urine, namely by the presence of vanillyl mandelic acid and homovanillic acid. So this is a very important point in identification of neuroblastomas in pediatric age group. Then we have these two rare tumors which we did not discuss. Just a line about each of them. Myelolipoma, these are benign tumors and extremely rare tumors. This is comprised of two terms, myelo and lipoma. So it has hematopoietic precursors which are scattered in and mature adipose tissue stroma. Then we have ganglioneuroma, which is again a benign tumor, rare tumor, and it has presence of these mature ganglion cells which are lying in fibrillary stroma. So this was all about tumors of adrenal. Amongst these, the most important one is pheochromocytoma, on which you can at times get a note.